Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Coffee and Chaos. And tonight, you know, there's always, when you're out socially, there's always a time or somebody there who has some very interesting stories, and that you just listen to these fascinating tales and you sit back and say, oh my God, what you've done and what you've seen. You should write a book. Well, my guest tonight did just that. In fact, it's called You Ought to Write a Book by George. And my guest today is George Boyle. George, welcome.
Welcome
to the show.
Thank
George
you much.
Spent a good 25 years or so working as a cameraman for KDKA. Through the course of his adventures, his love for shooting cameras and photography meshed with his love for water, and he was able to do some really fascinating things combining the two. And of course, they're all detailed in this book. You Ought to Write a Book by George. George, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
How did it come about that the camera and the water kind of blended in your career?
Well, the camera started when I was 10 years old. Mm-hmm. A neighbor boy in my neighborhood, next door neighbor, got a photographic developing kit for a Christmas present. He brought me over to his house to show me, and I was just fascinated by photography. Mm-hmm. So I saved up my money and I bought the developing package and the wherewithal to make some photographic prints. And it was magic to a 10-year-old boy. And the more I got involved with it, the more it grew. Mm-hmm. And I got in from still photography to motion picture work, to motion pictures with sound on them, mm-hmm. to mixing sound, and then into color photography. And later on in the career, the motion picture camera, like the one you have sitting in front of you now, mm-hmm. Became a dinosaur, and it evolved into video and videotaping. I got into that for a little bit at the tail end of my career. Mm-hmm. But most of the stories in my book are involved with motion picture, 16mm mm-hmm. motion picture film.
Okay. Is it okay if I lift this up?
Yeah, go ahead and lift it up.
Let's talk about this bad boy a little bit, because this has a lot of history here. What am I holding here? What is this?
You're holding a 16mm Bolex motion picture camera. Mm-hmm. You're also holding the camera that shot the very first film of Bill Mazeroski's World Series winning home run on October 13th, 1960. Mm-hmm. And as I record in my book, that film was also shot with my excited wife beating on my back with both fists, screaming, "We did it, we did it, we did it," and I couldn't stop shooting long enough to tell her to quit hitting me.
So the film was rather shaky then?
The film was rather shaky, and the guys in the newsroom accused me of being drunk, but I gave a taxi driver a $20 tip to take that film. As soon as the game was over, I hit the street and found a cab driver, gave him that film, and took it to the lab, wait for it, mm-hmm. take it right down to the station, and that was the very first film that was ever on the air of Maz's home run. Carl Ide, who was our 7 o'clock newscaster at the time, opened his show with that. And we didn't have live video back in 1960 like we have now.
Sure.
So that was the first film, the first pictures of Maz's home run that made it on the air.
I think he was the first news anchor to ever wear an eye patch.
Yeah, there's another story that's not in my book, but I was with Carl promoting the YMCA sports program, mm-hmm. and we had a trampoline in the gym, and I said, "Why don't you jump up and down on the trampoline?" He did. He fell, and he jarred his eye and tore his retina that had missed surgery. And because of my suggestion, he lost the sight of his eye.
Oh, geez.
And that's a story that's not in my book, and this is the first that's ever been told.
Really?
Yeah.
So we have an exclusive.
You got an exclusive, but I wish you never had it, because I feel bad to this moment.
Well, he didn't hold you responsible.
No, of course not. He could have said no on my eye.
Sure.
And the accident was just him tripping and falling and bouncing on the trampoline.
Yeah.
But it jarred his retina loose, and they couldn't repair it.
Wow. Now, this camera is actually, this is heavy.
Yeah.
It's a heck of a lot heavier than the video cameras we use today. Is this all you needed, or did you need to attach this to batteries and lights?
No, it winds that crank on the right side. There
right
is a wind-up handle.
Okay.
And you want to play with it, or you want me to show you
how to do it? You're the man.
Okay.
You can do that.
Well, you get about so much time running, and you crank it up like so. It's already wound up.
There you go.
I'll put it here by my microphone so you can hear it click. And those little clicks tell you 1,001, 1,002, 1,003. Yeah. So you can keep a mental idea of how much you're filming before you have to stop and wind again.
Sure.
You know, if you, as you're shooting something and you hear the last click, stop, rewind it.
And then have to look, and this is what went in there. The film.
Yeah, that's that is a can of a film, and that's the take up reel.
This is the take up reel here.
I'll even open it up so you can see
the film here that that they shot back in the day.
Yeah.
And how much time would you get on this?
2.5 minutes of 2 minutes and 40 seconds of recording time. Here's the interior of the camera.
Nice.
And there's a take up reel in there. You can see it turning as I.
Yep. Absolutely.
So that's what got Maz running around the bases.
Shaky, because your wife was
she was an absolute Pittsburgh Pirate fan.
Sure.
God rest her soul. I lost her to Alzheimer's disease in 1993. Mm. But she was so excited when that ball went over the wall that she just jumped up, and we had seats. I tell the whole story in the book about how I wrote checks out for tickets and received tickets for game 7. Mm-hmm. And our news director, Dick Muller at the time, was a New Yorker. And I told him when I got the tickets, I said, if this series goes to 7 games, I'm not working that day. Mm-hmm. I'm taking my wife to the ball game.
Mm-hmm.
Ha! 7. It's going to be the Yankees in 4. You know, boom, 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 boom. Big New Yorker. Well, 3-3. It came down to the last game. Yeah. And he's passing out press passes and roving passes, roof passes, clubhouse passes, the whole. And I said, "Well, hold it. Remember what I told you? I'm taking my wife to the ball game." He said, "You go ahead and take your wife, but here's your pass. Take your camera along. If something happens, you start shooting."
Ah.
So that's why the camera was with me. We were in section 1, row A, right behind Clemente.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
And when Tony Kubek went to field a ball from the Yankees, and it bounced up and hit him in the Adam's apple, and he went down. The camera came out of the case, and from there on in, I was shooting every pitch.
Wow.
And Hal Smith hit a home run that tied it up, and then when Terry threw that ball to Mazeroski and he hit it over the fence, I started shooting, and she started hitting.
Do you still have the film? Or
no, it's in KDK's archive somewhere. Yeah. I didn't get to keep that kind of film.
Yeah.
But they did accuse me of having a couple of drinks at the game. The guys in the newsroom saw that shaky film.
Yeah, I'm sure blaming your wife didn't go over well.
That was not typical of the kind of product I put on the air.
Now, this camera thing took an even bigger change, and I might be making a leap here, but we have over here something that's rather interesting, and this is a device. Is this okay, or will this fall apart?
Well, you're gonna realize something right off the bat.
It's probably heavy.
It's 23 pounds.
Okay, yeah, it
only
is.
Only 3 pounds of it is camera.
Wow.
There's
okay.
20
can
pounds.
You see that?
There's 20 pounds of lead built out into that case, which
shows different angles. Here.
I actually molded in a coffee can so it would have the contour shape of the housing and fit in there.
This is heavy.
Yeah. But that is absolutely zero buoyant, perfectly neutral buoyant when you put it in water.
And that's exactly what this is for, right?
Yeah, it's because you're using it underwater. And all that's watertight. It's built with O-rings to keep the water out from the controls that that wind it, the controls at the trigger mechanism. Mm-hmm. In the front, you have a...
We're killing our cameramen here. We really are. But I'll hold this up to you if you can zoom in on this. This is a picture of George. Did you say you were in the Bahamas?
I was going into the ocean in Bermuda on that particular shot.
And this is what you're looking at right below me. This is the casing, and here he is using it. You have that? Okay, because I'm about to change it on you again. You ready? Good thing our cameramen are
using
here
fast.
Because
they're fast.
Here's a shot.
There I am using it deep down, and that's probably in the Bahamas somewhere. Yes, I know it is. That's off of Freeport, Grand Bahama, and I was filming a guy who found one of the Spanish treasure ships.
Hmm.
And we had some of the Spanish pieces of 8 reburied into the sand so we could reenact the finding of them.
Uh-huh.
And I actually got, as a souvenir from that shoot, two Spanish, and I'm sorry, Fiore, I didn't think to bring them along.
That's okay.
But I have a picture of me underwater holding those two pieces of eight Spanish nice. Coins, silver coins.
Nice. And if you can see this, he's jury-rigged this thing so he can control his camera lens
the
from
aperture.
Out here and everything. This is really slick. Now, things like this had to exist at the time, didn't they?
Yeah, but I couldn't afford to buy it.
I see. So you just went ahead and made this instead.
I started out my family very early. I married when I was 20. I had my first child at 21. Mm-hmm. And by the time 1960 rolled around, I had three girls and two boys already. Mm-hmm. And then one more waiting in the wings for another chance.
Wow. This one, this is pretty slick. I'm gonna slide this back to where it was. That thing is heavy.
It's 20. I just weighed it just to out of my own curiosity. It's 23 pounds.
Okay.
And the handles have lead in them too to keep it keep so that all the weight isn't in the front.
And once you had it in the water,
once
it was
you
fine.
Have it in the water, you can just move it as easy as be if it was in the air.
That's pretty slick.
Yeah, it's perfectly neutral.
Now, we also have related to the water, we have this guy right here. And if I can put our cameraman to work again. Here we go. Now, there you go.
What you have in your hands is a U.S. diver's scuba knife and tool, as they call it. It's serrated on the one edge. And that knife is responsible for saving my life when I was lost and trapped under the ice.
Why don't you go ahead and
tell us
what happened
there. Which is another chapter 10 in my book. You'll remember a guy from the Pittsburgh radio days called Reg Kordick.
Absolutely.
Well, Reg Kordick had a gag show. Anything that he could do for a gag, he would do. One time, one of the young people in our city drove his car off the unfinished bridge, Fort Duquesne Bridge. The Bridge to Nowhere,
yeah,
that's
I remember
it.
That well.
You remember the Bridge to Nowhere? We all remember the Bridge to Nowhere. Well, there was a college student drove his car off the Bridge to Nowhere, and I wished I knew what chapter that was right off. I should know these things. I wrote the darn book, didn't I? But anyway, Reg Kordick made fun. Here it is, right here on chapter 6. I'll make your other cameraman work a little bit
here.
That's Reg Kordick putting a bumper sticker on the car that went off the end of the bridge and making up a gag sport called bridge jumping.
Oh, geez.
Bridge leaping. And the sticker says Kordick and Company, which was his program's name, Kordick and Company. Kordick and Company Bridge Leap. He had a contest. We done with that? Okay. He had a contest that the person who put a bumper sticker on the most unusual place would win a free trip to San Francisco. Well, I wanted to win that trip. I knew in a quarry 40 miles north of Butler, Pennsylvania, there was a car that had been driven off a cliff and was lying upside down in the water, clear water, in this stone quarry pool. So on the 13th of March, 1965, myself and my fellow diver, Jack Waite, took a trip to Butler North with underwater camera and bumper stickers to put a bumper sticker on this car that was laying underwater, figuring that would be the most unusual place anybody could ever think of, and we'd win the trip to San Francisco.
Sure.
Well, we hadn't realized that March 13th and 40 miles north of Butler was still cold enough that everything was frozen over. We got to that quarry pool, and it had not thawed. We had a layer of ice over the top of it, but we weren't to be daunted. We had our wetsuits. We had our knives. We dug a hole in the ice, and we went in. And I was on the shore getting my camera ready. I'll pretend this is the underwater camera. And I'm putting it up to my face, and I have a snorkel off my mask. It was in my way. I thought, I don't need this. I'm not going to be swimming around the surface. I'm going underwater, so what do I need this for? I took it off and laid it on the ground, and then I went in. Jack Waite went into the hole first, and then I got the camera ready and went in behind him. He started off towards where we knew the car was, and as his flippers were kicking, he stirred up some silt. First thing, when I went underwater with the camera, the cold water frosted up my mask.
Oh, geez.
So I had to fill my mask up with water, take a second, blow the air into my mask, clear the water down out of it, and now that I could see again, start out where I thought I was following Jack. Uh-uh. Somehow he tapered this way and I tapered the other way or vice versa. I don't know which, but I lost contact with him. I kept trying to find him. And I don't want to make this a real long story, but point was, I never did find him. I never did find the hole where I came in.
Oh, wow.
And I thought, well, I'll just get somewhere over to the shore and push up against the ice and break through and get out of here.
Mm-hmm.
I got to where I could stand up under the ice, and I pushed as hard as I could, and that ice would not budge.
Mm.
Well, I panicked for a second.
Sure.
Well, one thing you got to remember about scuba diving, there's not enough air in your tank and then you're coming through your regulator to let you go, I like that, when you get excited and pant. And I realized that. So I sat right down on the bottom of the lake and let myself relax. And I got that knife out. Give me mm-hmm. hand me that knife.
Yeah, sure.
Because I dug a hole in an oblong shape, and then I started to dig another one alongside of it in an oblong shape, because it seemed to me that was the fastest way. And it started to get hard to breathe. My scuba tank has a reserve J-valve, as they call it,
mm-hmm.
and it has a hook that comes down along the side of the tank, and when you need that last reserve of air, you pull on this rod,
mm-hmm.
and it pulls your valve down and releases 300 more pounds of air,
mm-hmm.
so you can finish up what you were doing.
How long will that give you?
Oh, about 10 minutes, maybe.
Oh, okay.
But unbeknownst to me, when I was pushing up against the ice to try and break through it, I pushed against the J-valve and already had knocked it down. Now, every breath I'm taking is like, well, I had the first oval hole made and I had the second oval pretty much started. But I was digging with one hand, digging up. I put both hands on the knife. I had rubber gloves on. Mm-hmm. I had both hands on, because I'm using it as a pry bar now,
mm-hmm.
to crack that ice between the two holes. Get me up. Unbeknownst to me, again, cut through my rubber glove, cut through my finger, and I didn't care if I cut my whole hand off. I needed to breathe.
Yeah.
I cracked it just enough that I could take off my mask and get my nose up into the hole. I couldn't get my whole head out yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I got my nose up into the hole, and I had enough space between. And anybody tells you that there's an airspace between ice and the water and the ice?
Yes.
No, there isn't. Not unless it's tidal water with a tide going in and out. On clear, still water, that's smack dab water to ice. So you got to get up to where there's air. And I got myself to where I could breathe out my nose.
Mm-hmm.
Got a couple of breaths, held my breath, come back down, used it. Knife a few more times, got the whole little, finally got enough room to get my whole head out.
Mm-hmm.
Finally got a hole big enough to get my shoulders out and got my whole head up to where I could look around. And over on the other side of the quarry pool, I see a knife coming up through the ice. Jack had the same problem,
but he
had double tanks. I had a single.
Yeah.
He had plenty of air. He wasn't worried about running out of air. He was just digging himself a nice hole.
Yeah.
He got out, saw what I was doing, came over to help me out. By the time we got the hole big enough for my shoulders and everything to come out, I put my hands up on the ice to pull myself out. I had a glove full of blood. I didn't know that I had cut. I just turned that ice all solid red. I had a glove full of blood there when I was coming out of there.
Yeah.
So, but the very next day, my youngest son was baptized. I almost missed his baptism.
Wow.
I had to go to Butler Hospital, get my finger stitched up and taken care of. We went back the next week and took the picture.
Geez.
Oh, yeah. We weren't going to let that show us down. We went back the next week, took the picture of the thing on the car.
Uh-huh.
We took along everything you could possibly need, ropes, things.
Yeah, yeah.
And got the... Do you know who won the trip to San Francisco? A guy who put a bumper stick on the mayor's limousine.
Oh, jeez. Bet he didn't have to cut through any ice for that. Huh?
Well, no, whatever. I mean, I've had to avoid the cop scene and putting this thing on the mayor's car. But that's who won the thing.
Ah, after all that.
So that's another water and photography that almost got me into trouble.
Now, one of the neat things when you're a photographer for a unit, especially if you're doing nature and stuff, is sometimes, I mean, technically speaking, the cameraman has to be the first one there because he's got to record everything. So we have a rather interesting story. Put you to work again there, brother. Here we go. This is
Angel Falls, Venezuela, the world's highest waterfall, the first fall from the top of the plateau to the widening part below is 3,212 feet. You could stack Niagara Falls 19 times up that first waterfall.
Wow.
Then it flows. You've got a wider shot there.
I do.
You show the ribbon falls and the skirt mountain. There's another 4,000 feet of mountain and skirt falls that falls down from that.
Got that? Got it, or did I hold it up too high there?
The Pittsburgh Zoo mounted an expedition to Angel Falls to try and find some species of animal and or fish for their new zoo and aquarium that would be noteworthy and give them something. That is me standing at the very top of the falls, getting ready to film the guys that were coming over to hold the flags over
there.
So
technically speaking, you were the first guy.
Only because of my position as a cameraman.
Sure.
I had to be there to film them arriving.
Now, if you think George going under water without a drag line rope around him, or you know, you think that was crazy, let me show you this picture.
Well, that's how we had to get over to the edge. That surface up there is not a ball field. It's all interlaced with crevasses and,
yeah.
And
cuts. Now tell us, George, how deep?
I have no idea how deep, because you couldn't see the bottom. You couldn't see the bottom of that crevasse, but we had to get over some places like that to get to the edge.
It's not only bad enough that George is jumping over this endless crevasse here, but look what George is holding right here. That's extra weight. That's his camera gear. And why were you carrying the camera gear?
Because I had to have the camera to get the film of them coming across to the edge of the falls.
He told me he didn't trust throwing it to anybody else, so he kept it himself when he's leaping over these things to get to the top. That's pretty adventurous stuff there.
Well, I'll tell you a story. After we got to the edge of the falls, hold up the picture of the Angel Falls itself, that first one that you showed.
No, the first one?
There is always updrafts coming up the face of the cliffs. Okay. So we had four flags. We had the American flag, of course.
Sure.
We had the City of Pittsburgh flag. We had the Zoological Society flag. And we had the Explorers Club flag. I forget who was holding all the other flags, but Pat Lawton, the head of the parachute team, was holding the Explorers Club flag.
Okay.
And I wanted to pan shot across all four flags as they held them over the edge of the falls.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the American flag was heavy bunting. The other flags, the City of Pittsburgh flag was heavy. The zoo flag was heavy, but the Explorers Club flag was a thinner material, and the updrafts were catching it and flopping it back up in Pat's face. So I'm waiting till the updrafts weren't constant. They would come and go. I'm waiting until they subsided, and I could get a nice straight pan shot across all four flags.
Sure.
Meanwhile, he's the head of the parachute jumping team. He's jumped out of open doors of airplanes 2,000 times in his life, at least. He said, "For God's sake, George, will you get this shot? I'm turning green standing up here." He could not take standing at the edge of that falls and looking 3,000 feet down to nothing when he didn't have a parachute. I said, "Pat, your problem is you don't have a parachute on your back." He said, "Yeah, if I had my parachute, I could jump out and track." I said, "Well, I got the camera. You go get the shoot." That was a Mexican standoff. It didn't. He never did it. But we had fun.
George, you brought a ton of stuff here, and
all right. Well, while we're on Angel Falls, we had six scientists up there, and one of the scientists was Professor Ernest Ernesto Foldatz, mm-hmm. who was the head of the Instituto Botanico, the Botanical Institute for the University of Caracas. Mm-hmm. And he was searching for the botany up there, the flowers, the plants, everything. And I went with him on a day of excursion exploration. And while he was checking on all these plants, mm-hmm. he found a new species of South American orchid that had never been classified before. Mm-hmm. So as I'm filming him, he said, George, what's your wife's name? And I said, her name is Mary Regina. Oh, Orchidea Maria Regina. I name it for her. Well, I was so honored to mm-hmm. have a South American orchid named after the lady who pounded on my back for the World Series, that when we got back to Caracas, I bought the orchid that you're holding in your hand, that orchid pin with a pearl in it, and another one like it for her mother, and another one like it for my mother, and one for my godmother, and one for all three of my daughters. And I almost spent all of the money I made on that expedition bringing back gold orchid pins for the ladies in my life.
That's pretty cool stuff. George, before we fast run out of time, we better make a mention of the book. Now, let me just point out a couple of things to you here. We have, this is a buckskin jacket, which was made for George, specifically for the by the Indians. And this thing next to it is not a walking stick, but rather a blowgun. And I think you have a poison
a quiver,
arrow there, don't you?
There's a quiver with the darts.
Yep.
The poison darts. Here's one of the arrows. I can let
there you go.
I cleaned the poison off of that one.
Yeah, well, you can still see, though, the tip is dark.
Last week, I was at the Oakmont bookstore with a book signing, and I demonstrated this and shot it into a balloon, burst a balloon.
All of these things here, plus a whole lot more that George didn't bring, all have stories to them. And those stories, at least a good portion of them, are detailed in George's book. And before we fast run out of time, we need to describe and tell people how they can get this book.
Well, the best way to do it is to get in touch with me.
Mm-hmm. What's the best way for them to do that?
Call me at area code 724-274-8501, and I will be happy to mail a copy of this book to anybody that sends me a check.
There you go. And the book is You Ought to Write a Book by George. And what's the book going for, George? Do we want to say that?
Yeah, my publisher charged me for the first 100 books that I got. He charged me $19.50 a book plus $252 tax. So I've been selling them for $20. I've been losing money on every book I sell. But I just wanted to let everybody get, a chance to read it without me being in the hole.
Sure. And we'll put that number down below for you again. If you want, call George and he'll send you a book. There are an awful lot of... and there's some good quotes from people in the back of this too, Fred Rogers and Don Riggs, if you remember him. So some good old times back as a cameraman for KDKA, and of course the mixing of his water stories. George, I can't thank you enough for stopping by the studio today for Coffee and Chaos. This was an absolutely great episode. There's a lot more stories we could have gotten to you. We might have to have you back again.
Whatever you think. We just had the chaos. Where's the coffee?
That'll come when we shut the cameras and the lights off. There you go. I'd like to thank George Boyle for stopping by. His book, You Ought to Write a Book
by George.
There you go. And you can find out these tales and a whole lot more. That's going to wrap up Coffee and Chaos today. Until next time, I'm Fiore. Good evening, everyone.